the second day of our meeting, and we have our keynote speaker today, Zahra Awad. It is my pleasure to introduce Zahra to you, but though maybe not necessary, but it is a ritual. She received a doctorate from State University in New York, writing a dissertation, The Relative Gravity of Lexical Errors in Second Language Learning. She has been on the faculty at University of Jordan since 2004, and she has also taught at Jordan University of Science and Technology. At the moment, she is visiting scholar at Ludwig Maximilian University in Munich. Her research has focused on cross-cultural communication, discourse analysis, foreign language learning and teaching, ESP, and CALL. She has published extensively in these fields and co-authored two textbooks on ESP. She is a member of the editorial boards of the International Journal of Arabic English Studies and Voices in Asia Journal. She is a recipient of several awards and research grants. Her presentation today is entitled Arab Women in Western Print Press During the Arab Spring, Images and Attitudes. So it is our pleasure to listen to this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Santulli, for the introduction. I'm very happy to be here and to contribute to this wonderful conference, although I'm going to tackle it from a different perspective, and it's European periodicals dealing with issues outside Europe. So it's a little bit different from other presentations yesterday, although there were like some presentations on China and other countries. So, in fact, this is a joint research project, and I have a research team with colleagues from Germany, Dr. Monica Kerner-Ludwig, and colleagues from Jordan, Dr. Merzi Sawalha, who's going to present also today. And we have research assistants also helping in this project. In fact, this project, I started this project 3 years ago at Ludwig Maximilian University, and when I was visiting, I was on a study visit there, and I was, working on headlines at that time. And then I expanded the project and included more German universities in the project and more participants. So I'm going first to give you an introduction about the role of media in shaping public attitudes. Then concentrate on newspapers and their effect on the readers. Then later on I will look at Arabs in media, in Western media in general, and then look at Arab women, the stereotypes of Arab women in media, in Western media, and then if this image and stereotype has changed during the Arab Spring, then I'll present some data, some statistics about how we try to find out if this stereotype has shifted or changed because of the events, the political events that took place in the last few years in the Middle East, especially in some Arab countries. So let me first look at media and attitudes. So of course, I think we all aware that media plays a very important role in shaping public attitudes, and many scholars like Schramm and Perflow and Bushman, they published on it for like decades on this. Yeah. And this is why media discourse is considered a tool for social change, because this could help or could lead to modifying attitudes and social orientation. I'm going to just to summarize this using Shaw's words. Quote, this is a quote from Shaw: "The media are persuasive in focusing attention on specific events and giving the importance people attach to public matters. The agenda setting theory says, because of newspapers, people are aware or not aware, pay attention or neglect, play up or downgrade specific features of the public scene. People tend to include or exclude from their cognition what media include or exclude from their content, and unquote. So this summarizes basically the role of media in shaping attitudes. Now, I'm going to concentrate, like I mentioned in the introduction, I will concentrate on newspapers. For a long time, like, newspapers have been the means of giving news, and now things are changing with digital news and websites, etc. So newspapers for a long time was the source of the news, and the relationship between the readers and the newspapers are really complex, because journalists, they construct information based on their intention, what they want to broadcast or give to their readers, and the interpretation by the readers or audiences affects their attitudes and mindsets or even their actions. It is not necessary that what the journalists write is perceived the same way they intended, because all of us have our own mindsets, so we could interpret news differently, not necessarily the way the journalist intended. So comprehending news or understanding news goes through several stages, and it's very similar to reading comprehension, except for the last few points. I mean, in addition to perception and attention and decoding and interpretation and representation in episodic memory, we have formation and the formation, the uses and updating the situation models, and uses and changes of general social knowledge and beliefs, including frames, scripts, attitudes, and ideology. This is according to Van Dyck. Yeah. In particular, ideology is affected a lot by media and newspapers. According to Baker and Gabrieltas and McHenry, the press do not, or sorry, should be does not just reflect reality, but have the function of constructing ideologically motivated version of reality. And in fact, basically now, maybe you notice that in the last, let's say, two decades or so, journalists are changing from being recorders to interpreters. Not necessarily they just tell you what happens. They put it in a way to affect, either aware or not aware, depending on the political leaning of the newspaper or the news media. So the problem with this is that this could lead to distorted perception of the world rather than continuous exploration. And it's very important to raise the awareness of readers, including like students and everybody and the public, of the role of media in changing their attitudes and shaping their attitudes. And as I mentioned, that because reporters are becoming more interpreters rather than recorders, they could produce, they could manipulate language and produce messages that could affect the values and the worldview and the symbolic system of the society. So, for example, they can concentrate on a specific stereotypes of certain nations and distort that, or the other way around. I mean, they can glorify it. It depends on their political leaning, you know. And, you know, this could shift, I mean, the messages could shift depending on political decisions. I mean, what is presented negatively could be presented positively depending on the government and stance towards certain issues. So, uh, This is the general introduction about media and its effects on public attitudes. I want to concentrate on Arabs in Western media and then on Arab women in Western media. Now, it is well known that Arabs in Western media have a negative image, and this has been recorded by several scholars. We have Shaheen and Gabrieltos and McHenry, and this became even worse after September 11th. And usually the images or their portrayal, their depiction in media is unrealistic and unfair sometimes. So because they deal with them as one body. I mean, you know, we have so many variations in the Arab world. I mean, we have the Arab countries are in two continents, and have so many different, even within the Arab world, you have different cultures and different differences in different, you could find a huge difference between two Arab countries, although they speak the same language, and mostly, they have similar religions. Basically, we have Muslims, mostly Muslims, but we have also Christians, and we have Jews living also in Arab countries. So you have variations, but they are dealt with as one body. As for Arab women, usually they are presented as being oppressed, as being victims of their male victims of their society, and also as being obedient to their male compatriots, but which is not really true. I mean, if you visit Arab countries, you can see the differences, and people are judged, or women are judged, on their appearances. They think if they, later on we'll see, there is a lot of concentration on the way they dress, their attire, and they think because they wear long dresses and they cover their heads, it means that they cover their minds, which is not true. I mean, you have a lot of activists and a lot of, you know, scientists, etc., who wear, you know, the Islamic dress, but they are very active and open-minded. In Europe and in Germany, I said Germany because you have a huge, or let's say very big, Turkish population. There are around 6 million people, and many of them are Muslims, and they wear, also women wear the headscarf, or they call it kopftuch. So they confuse the Arab women with Muslim women. Although not all Muslims are Arabs, and not all Arabs are Muslims. So you have Arab women who are not Muslims, and you have a lot of women who are not Arabs. So you have in Indonesia and in Malaysia and Turkey and Iran, etc. They are not Arabs. So, but it is confused usually. As I mentioned earlier, the events, the political events and the uprisings that took place in the last 5 or 6 years in some Arab countries, referred to as Arab Spring, it affected the image of Arabs in general and also of women in particular. Now, the Arab Spring, the uprisings took place in some Arab countries like Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, Yemen, and Syria, and still going on in Syria, and also in Bahrain, but it affected the whole Arab country. And so we will notice later on when we analyze all these articles within that period. So it's not only, the reports are not only about women in those particular countries like Tunisia and Egypt, etc., but it was also about other countries which were considered as stable, but they are reported, like about Jordan, about Palestine, about Saudi Arabia, Emirates, and Morocco, Algeria. So you notice also these events affected all women or all Arabs across the Arab world, not only in those particular countries. In fact, the work that has been done on the image or the depiction of Arab women in media during that particular period from 2010 till 2015, although the Arab Spring is really considered between 2011 and 2012, but the aftermath is still going on. So, I mean, this is why I said during and after the Arab Spring. So, although it started at in Tunisia in 2010, in December 2000, at the end of 2010, it continued and is still continuing till now. Yeah. So, our study is really a linguistic study. We're not, I mean, we're analyzing the language that is used for in portraying Arab women. Of course, you have visuals, usually that pictures that accompany the articles. But we're not really into that. We want to concentrate on words and on headlines. So basically, our study is a linguistic study. So the study basically want to see if attitudes towards Arab women changed because of the media reports about them during the Arab Spring. Because the Arab women took a very important role during the uprisings. I mean, that was like, if you say 5 years ago, or let's say 6 years ago, you will see marches of women in Yemen, in Egypt, and et cetera. They took a very important role in the uprisings. So this, we hypothesize that maybe this will change their typical stereotype as being oppressed or being victimized, et cetera. So we want first to see what is the attitudes of German students towards Arab women, and then see how they are portrayed during that period in the news that are mostly read by the students in different newspapers and news magazines, and then compare or to see investigate whether the Western press, or including German, British, and American, affected their perception or their opinions of Arab women. Why Germany? Why did I choose Germany? Like, it's Germany because in the last couple of years, we have a lot of refugees, Arab refugees in Germany. I mean, like more than 1 million people, more than 1 million refugees in Germany. And many of those refugees are women, and they can be identified easily by the way they are dressed. And we hypothesize that because they dress differently than European women, like maybe their perception is different. And we also hypothesize that this could also be due to what people read about women, and this will affect their opinion. Our research project was conducted, as I mentioned, in two stages, in the first two phases. The first phase was only headlines, and I started that in 2014, and it's already finished, and it's going to be published very soon, an article about the headlines. And the second phase is the analysis of the full articles, and we want to compare between the two. I will concentrate on the headlines and maybe mention a little bit about the articles, and my co-researcher, who is with us here today, Dr. Majdi Sawalha, who's in corpus linguistics and natural language processing, he's going to maybe concentrate more on the articles, and he will explain more about the methodology. And yeah. So now, why did I choose headlines first? I chose headlines because, I mean, it's a basic reading strategy, and according in Van Dyck's words, understanding a headline, understanding a headline presupposes activating relevant concepts, knowledge, frame, or scripts, or previous models about the event, and at the same time, new opinions are formed or existing ones activated about the event denoted by the headline. This is why it's like the topic. The headline is very important. It really, based on that, the headline, you decide whether you want to read the full article or not. We conducted the study in four stages. In the first stage, we tried to explore students, German university students' readership of news, like what kind of news they read. Do they read news in a foreign language or not? And then to identify reports about Arab women that were published by these news media that the students basically mostly read. After that, we analyzed the reports for expressions, describing Arab women. Then at the end, we compared the most common expressions and significant expressions that featured in the press with those that the students mentioned in their responses to the questionnaire. Our questionnaire was launched through an electronic platform, eSurvey Creator, and we piloted it on 30 people. And we started in November 2014. Three universities were included, Ludwig Maximilian University, Augsburg University, and Würzburg University. So we have three German universities participating in this study. The questionnaire, we have 29 questions, four sections. The first section, we have four questions about background. The second one, we have 10 questions about what kind of news do they read and in what languages, what are the sources. And the third question, the third section consists of five questions about discourse analysis and critical reading. I mean, when they do the do the students take into consideration who's the writer and what is the source or not, or they just take whatever they read? And the fourth section has 10 questions about attitudes towards cultures, different cultures in general, and towards Arabs and Muslims, and about and opinions of Arab women. This is like our participants. They are between the age of 18 and 51, 26% males and 72% females. Basically, mostly are native speakers of German, studying, most of them are studying English. And we have 287 participants from three German universities, the ones I mentioned. It seems that most of the students, they read the news regularly. Also, more than 50% read in a foreign language, like whether once a day or once, more than once a day or at least once a week. Their interest in Arab women, we asked them whether they are interested to read about Arab women or not. It was like around 50% were interested. The news sources they used, basically you have German news, Der Spiegel, Süddeutsche Zeitung, and Frankfurt Allgemeine Zeit. Excuse my German pronunciation, I'm just learning German. And the most popular ones among them, the English news, were the New York Times and the Guardian. So when we asked them about attitudes, because we're interested in attitudes, we noticed that, more than half of them, they believe that people have a negative, in Europe and the US, they have negative perception of Arabs. Let me just hear, you see. And also they think that the media, around 50%, they think that media in Europe and US is not totally objective. And around also 40% believe that reports about different cultures are not always accurate. Now, the image, what is interesting here is the last three questions. The image of Arabs in the press is usually negative. In fact, we have more than 50% believe so. And the representation of Muslims is generally negative, also more than around 60%, I believe so. But when it comes to Arab women, it's different. Now, 50%, they are not sure whether they're negative or not. In fact, around like 25%, they believe, they don't agree that their image is negative. In their responses, we will see later on, they sympathize with the Arab women. They feel that they are victimized. They feel that they are oppressed, etc. So we'll see that later on in when we look at the words that they used. So here you can see, these are, we asked them which adjectives describing Arab women are most common in the news they read. And then we asked them how do they themselves perceive Arab women. So we want to see if they think, if what they think or their opinion of Arab women is affected by what they think appear in the news. And then we look at what really features in the news. So what they think of Arab women, what they think the news says about Arab women, and what actually is said, because it's not the same. What you think the media says is not necessarily what is actually said. Yeah. So as you can see, they believe that the most common adjectives that they believe that the news used in order to describe Arab women are like they are oppressed, suppressed, discriminated against, abused. But at the same time, they have also some, during that period, they have some positive ones, like strong, brave, proud, because they were participating in the uprising. But also they have also, they are conservative because of their attire maybe, and they have veiled and covered and yeah. When we compared what they used to describe Arab women, the adjective, with what they think is said about them in the news. So you can see here, you can see most adjectives that they use to describe Arab women occur in the news, except for being proud and open. They believe so, but which is, of course, the percentage is not very high, but some people at least think so. Now, this is about the questionnaire, what the students think, their opinions, etc. Now we come to the articles themselves. Yeah? We compiled two corpora, one in English and one in German. The English has the New York Times and the Guardian articles, and the German ones have the German news media, including Der Spiegel and Süddeutsche Zeitung and the other ones which are were mentioned, yeah? So we used corpus linguistics and discourse analysis for the methodology. In corpus linguistics, we have huge data that represents what actually, how language is used in reality. And it really, it gives a more realistic image of or perception of what actually the syntactic patterns that occur in real life, because you have huge data. And the tools we use, we have two programs, ANTCOC and Sketch Engine, and I think maybe Dr. Majdi is going to talk about these tools, about the analysis. The second one is discourse analysis, it's qualitative. The other one is quantitative, the corpus linguistics. This one is qualitative. Basically, we concentrate on, in discourse analysis, what text producers, the role of text producers in constructing meaning, and the audience's interpretation of texts, and how it affects their mindsets, their opinions, and their actions. This is our corpora. We have totally, we have 212,254 words in the German corpus, and 738,964 words in the German, the English corpus. Of course, when we search them, we search for different words in English and in like the English corpus, we use English words, of course, and for the German corpus, we use German words. We want to see which adjectives or which words collocate, they occur with the word Arab woman. So we used all words that could refer to women, like woman, female, girls, mothers, wife, wives, daughter, daughters, lady, ladies. But we have the highest one was woman, so this is why we chose it. Yeah, I mean, we the others are not very frequent. After investigating the words that collocate with the word woman in English and in German, of course in German we use Frau, Frauen, etc. Now we divided these words into topical frames. So which aspects of the image of Arab woman is really described by these words? And we identified 8 topical frames. These are activism, violence, oppression, rights, empowerment, dress regulations, marriage, and religion. I'm going to give you some examples of the words that occurred. In activism, I'm just going to give you some words, like some examples from headlines. And maybe Dr. Majdi will continue with the articles later. Now we have words like protest, protesting, protester, activist, campaign, campaigner, fight, fighting, demand, feminism, feminist, etc. And we have the frequency and the look likelihood. The look likelihood tells us how significant it is, because we compare these words in our corpus with the general corpus. A corpus about women in general. And we want to see whether these words occur, particularly with Arab women or with women in general. So this is why we have to use this test, yeah. And maybe Dr. Majdi is better than me in this. So he's in natural language processing, so he can explain more. I'm going to give you some examples here. Like, for example, we have here mass march by Cairo women in protest over abuse by soldier. This was given by New York Times. And there's also another example from German newspaper, from Spiegel. I'm going to read the English translation because I don't want to make mistakes in pronunciation. So you have strong, smart, veiled Arab women keep on fighting for their rights after the rise of Islamists in Egypt and Tunisia. So these are some of the examples. For violence, also in the headlines, we have words like assault, rape, assault, assaulted, harassment, fears, etc. And we have here also examples of, this is an example from Spiegel, violence against women. The body guards from Tahrir Square, sorry about the spelling here, women in Egypt get insulted, felt up and raped on daily basis. Now, as for oppression, in fact, is the most common stereotypes of Arab women. There is a common stereotype in literature or in the news, basically, it's that they are victims of their society, they are oppressed by their male compatriots. So this is the general stereotypes, and this was highlighted both in the headlines and the news articles. And we have here the words like ban. In fact, with ban and banned, it refers most of the time to driving ban in Saudi Arabia, although it is only in one Arab country. We have 23 Arab countries, it's only one, but it is really highlighted a lot about banning driving for women. And we have other words here, and they are significant. I mean, anything which is above 5 is significant, and look at these, the look likelihood are really high, they are significant. So here the example about the driving ban in Saudi Arabia. Saudi women are being driven to rebellion. The driving ban in Saudi Arabia does little to actually protect women. It is merely a backward preemptive act of repression. This is from The Guardian. As for rights, the rights in the articles, I mean, we have words like, we use the word lemma, which is the root, I mean, instead of, because if you have right or rights, it will be the same lemma instead of, you know, having two words. So you have right, vote, revolution, revolt, women to drive, right to drive. This is an example also about for rights. Men overwhelmingly dominate the Arab Spring countries, but women, enabled by advances in literacy and higher education and increasingly asserting are increasingly asserting themselves. In Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Yemen, and Syria, they have been on the front lines of the revolution. So this is from the New York Times. As for dress regulation, this is from headlines. In the articles, we have much more. I mean, I just chose. We have basically veiled hijab, burqa, and basically I think it's the scarf, the headscarf, which really signify Arab women, like wearing something on the head. Otherwise, I mean, wearing long sleeves or long dresses doesn't really affect. The only identifier of Muslim women is wearing the headscarf, I mean, wearing something on the head. Otherwise, if they wear long sleeves or long dress, doesn't matter, as long as the head is not covered. So here we have an example. The hijab is aggressively marketed as a proper attire for respectable women. That isn't new. What is new is that now even children are targets of this marketing. I'm not sure if this is true or not. From a symbol of disempowerment, the veil now for some became a mark of liberation. Yeah. So. I like this one. This is about Jordan, again, because I come from Jordan. So with a headscarf beneath the helmet, police in West Jordan land recruits many women. They gladly join because there they find equal acknowledgement. So in Jordan, yeah, you have a lot of police women, and they wear headscarf, and they are police women. And so, and they feel equal to men. As for marriage, the different, lexical items and expressions indicating different aspects of marriage are much more frequent and significant in the articles more than in the headlines. And the most common expressions, we have child marriage, we have forced marriage, we have adultery, unwed, we have polygamy. These are the ones which are highlighted. Now, an example here in Libya, women have seen the reinstitution of polygamy. This is from New York Times. And the second one is from Süddeutsche Zeitung. Girls from Syria who fled to Egypt before the civil war are more and more often pushed into forced marriages with foreigners. This is to a certain extent, I think, is true. because, you know, as refugees and as like many of their maybe parents or their husbands, whatever, are killed during the war, so they consider that marriage is some kind of a safe haven for them, just, you know, not to be raped by other people. Or as for religion, it was like highlighted a lot in the news articles, especially in the last few years with the rise of the Islamic State, the rise of Islamists in Tunisia and Egypt after the revolution. And it has a very high significance in the articles as compared to the headlines. And we have so many words that refer to religion, like Muslim, non-Muslim, religious, religion, ISIS, Christianity, Salafi, Salafist, etc. So now here we have, it's interesting that because we have the examples here which were highlighted also in the headlines, they are about women in countries which did not witness uprising. But like I said at the very beginning, the effect of the Arab Spring, the impact of it has, or the Arab Spring has its impact in all Arab countries across the Arab world. As for empowerment, they featured in the headlines more than in the news stories. And these are the examples, these are the words of empowerment. We have winner, compete, progress, pride, challenge, hope, educated. The most, in fact, later on, maybe in the news articles, we have Nobel Prize, Peace Prize. It's very significant in German and in the articles in the English corpus, it's significant too. It's about Tawakkul Kurman, this Yemeni activist who won the Peace Prize in 2011. So in fact, we have here an example. She's only 32. And here you have in a ceremony in Oslo that repeatedly invoked gender equality and democratic strivings of the Arab Spring. The 2011 Nobel Peace Prize was presented to three female activists and political leaders on Saturday for their nonviolent struggle for the safety of women and for women's rights as peacemakers. Tawakkul Kurman, a Yemeni journalist and political activist who at 32 is the youngest Peace Prize laureate and the first Arab woman to receive the award. This is from New York Times. And so what we did, in fact, after we investigated the most common collocates with Arab women and divided them into different themes, the eight themes, then we compared these words, the significant words, the collocates that featured in the news with what the students said in the questionnaire about it, and in order to see if there is some kind of similarities between the adjectives that they used and what actually occurred in the headlines. Of course, sometimes we did not find one-to-one, I mean, the same word, but we have words which have similar connotations or similar, they cover more or less the same semantic field. So, yeah. So we compared the adjectives that the students used to show their perception of Arab women with what actually happened, and this is from the headlines because the numbers are really small because they are from the headlines, but we did the same for the articles, and then the related words. So now what comes out of all of this? Our results shows that the news stories published during and after the Arab Spring distinguish between different Arab countries. You cannot just say Arab women. In the news, you have Yemeni women, Saudi women, Egyptian women. It's not like what was mentioned earlier in the literature, like Arab women, in general, as they were dealing with it as one body, monolithic. So I mean, but here they distinguish between different Arab countries. And in the news, we have two contradictory images of Arab women. You have the stereotypes, the old stereotype as being victims and oppressed by their society, to rights seekers and fighters. So you have two. You have a new image emerging as a rights seeker, as a fighter for the rights. And so this means that we have some kind of shift from the old stereotypes, from being helpless, passive, oppressed, etc., to more new image as being active, protesting, fighters, etc. So we have new images emerging. Yeah. Most of the adjectives that used by the German students actually occur in the headlines and in the articles. And in the German data, we found that the focus was on strong nouns and phrases that provoke different association of violence that featured in the Arab Spring. So the conclusion for all of this, the women in different Arab countries continue to be presented or represented with different shades of negativity. And I said the old stereotype is there. I mean, it's not finished, it's still there. But because of the so-called Arab Spring, there is some kind of shift in their image in the press. From passive victims to active protesters. And seekers of their new more rights. As I mentioned also earlier, like the image of Arab women continued to be overlapping with Muslim women. And I said this is b- because of their attire. I mean, it is really difficult to distinguish, because some women in some Arab countries, they look like Europeans. I mean, like they like Turkish or like some Europeans, because of they have light skin, especially in Lebanon and Syria, etc. So in the north, you have more lighter skin than. And it seems also that our students, they're aware of the potential manipulation being used by the press, because these are students of English. Maybe this, I mean, we cannot really generalize this for all students. These are students of linguistics, these are students of English. Maybe we can extend or expand this project to include students from different disciplines, because these students, like, they study discourse analysis, they study linguistics, they focus on critical reading. So maybe we need to expand or to include students from different disciplines, or not even students, I mean, like, maybe people from different walks of life, because, I mean, students are not representative of the whole society. So what do we get out of this, I mean, this study, why we are doing this? We suggest that it's important to incorporate media education in university courses across the board, because media is becoming more and more affecting people. And if people are not aware of the role of media in shaping their attitudes, then they will, you know, distort their perception of the whole world. And like I said, more research is needed on critical discourse analysis, not necessarily of treatment of Arabs, but also treatments of any, like, minority or not necessarily, like, particular. In this particular case, we have Arabs, but maybe we could look at certain minorities in certain societies and then try to see how the society, how the public perceive them. So it has several implications for further research. Maybe we could include, like I said, people, the opinion of people from different education levels, different professions, etc. And I think that's it. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this presentation. It was not only interesting to listen to the project and see the first results, but also the implications are quite interesting and are food for thought in their social and educational implication, I would say. Okay, so we have a little time for debate. So if there are questions,
thank you. It was really fascinating and very interesting about the comparison. Useful. I wanted to ask you, I was very interested in the fact that you found that newspapers were so significant in the information sources for students, and that there was a high percentage reading newspapers. My question is this: do you have any statistics? Did you ask questions about what medium? I mean, you keep talking about media.
Yeah.
So, what medium were the students finding their news? Was it online representation of newspapers, or was it the paper copies? Because I think that's an interesting area. And were you able? It seems to me that it is very difficult, or maybe there are people in this room who do know the answers to my queries here, including you, but it seems to me very difficult to trace the kind of analysis you offer us with the way in which I suspect now students get their news, which is through social media.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a much more difficult corpus to record, pin, down, you know, analyze,
use
as a researcher.
Yeah.
I guess, I'm asking, are there archives, for example?
Yeah.
And were you able to make in your mind a clear correlation between these two newspapers, which the students named, the Guardian and the, well, and the
these
German
are the
newspapers,
English ones, yeah.
and the three German titles you also described, or four?
Right.
Yeah. And what the students were actually, what their sources actually were. In other words, did they have information sources that were from social media? I use that word very loosely, but the representation of news on social media.
Mm-hmm.
Did you think about Al Jazeera, for example? I was interested that it wasn't there.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, those are the questions.
Okay. So to answer your question, your questions, So as for the newspapers, we ask for both. I mean, like most newspapers, they have websites.
Yeah.
Websites, the newspapers. I mean, like the Guardian.
They
have websites. So it's online and paper. And it's now like it's all shifting towards websites and digital news. Yeah, everything is now digital, you know. And in fact, for our next project, which is on refugees, and we're working on it now, we're really we're targeting digital news because they are much more common than newspapers. I mean, newspapers are becoming less and less, you know. I mean, and mostly people, including us ourselves. I mean, like we usually just check the news online, I mean, rather than go and buy newspapers, etc. So everything is moving towards, you know, digital world. So this is one thing. The other thing about social media, in this project we did not consider it, but I mean it is considered in our next project. I mean, like, where did they get the news? Did they get it by accident, like, you know, in social media, and you find the link and then you go there, or do you really seek to know what happens? It's different than like when you go to the website of a newspaper and open it and read the news. It's different than like if you're scrolling through your Facebook or Instagram or whatever, and you find or Twitter, etc., and you find the link. So it's not the same. Yeah. So we are totally aware of that, and we're considering that in our next project. Yeah. So yes. And I think this is the answer to the question.
Yeah.
At that point, we did not. I mean, what do you mean?
Why?
Include what? Why we didn't include it at that time? Maybe because, I don't know. we just like, at that time we want to focus on newspapers, and then when we have these results, and in their responses they mentioned also online, etc., and they draw our attention that they read online, and this is why it is included in this study. And it's like in the newspapers are both newspapers and websites, the news websites. They are included in our study. But the social media is not included. In our next project, we are including it, because more and more you find news. And also your attitude is different. I mean, if you seek to find the news, it's different than if you just know about it by accident. But then, I mean, I thought you were asking about the news media. I mean, like.
I was asking about newspaper terms.
Yeah.
In relation to the media. But
does it matter whether
maybe
they get.
You can discuss it over the coffee.
Yeah. So you're talking about access.
We
maybe.
Can have other questions.
Thank you, Dara, for your presentation. You made reference to the same semantic fields, terms belonging to the same semantic fields.
Yeah.
But it seems to me that words such as veiled and masked have very different connotations, although they belong to the same semantic fields. So I was wondering if you had also taken into account how the connotations of terms change in time, because must is, of course, yeah. references to security
yeah.
and security problems,
yeah.
so terrorism.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
maybe this would be also be a very interesting field of research.
Like covered is different from veiled, is different from must, of course, and everyone, each word has its own connotation, of course. But like, you know, it was beyond the scope of the study. It will be too long then. I mean, then maybe then later on, maybe we'll just concentrate on that aspect. Yeah, because it will be too, yeah, we took that into concentration, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for the interesting talk. I would be interested in how you selected the articles from the websites or from the online news. So was it just the headlines, where certain words had to appear, or how did you make the selection process of what is relevant and what is not relevant for representing Arab women?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, as I mentioned in the methodology, we took all the articles from October 2010 till June 2015. And we chose the articles which featured Arab women in the headline and the byline. Because sometimes there is, like, for example, you have the name of a person, like, for example, Tawakkul Kurman is a name. How would you know that she's an Arab? And yeah, so usually this is explained in the byline. So we took Arab women both in the headline and the byline, and then of course based on that we included the article in the analysis.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah.
I was wondering, I imagine this was a little bit beyond the scope of your investigation, but I was wondering about whether you could say anything about the selection process that I imagine happens when Western or European media, rather, take over news stories from maybe Al Jazeera or from local news sources. So could you say anything about that?
We didn't go that far.
we
didn't go that far. We just looked at, I mean, of course, it is all in our data. I mean, in our data, we have the full article and the source and everything. But I imagine even if they take it from a source, maybe they reword it according to, yeah, I mean, does it matter the source? Because I think it's, you can take the same piece of news and from the same source, reported by different news media, and they will be rewarded in a different way depending on the political leaning of the source, the news source, and on different, yeah.
Sure.
So yeah, but we didn't really look at the source itself, because, you know, I mean, you're talking about the news agency or like, yeah, but then we didn't go that far. It will be beyond the scope of our study, but yeah. It's there. I mean, maybe we should. Thank you. I mean,
well, maybe I should just, sentence clarify. Like, I was just it piqued my interest, because looking at your topical frames, I thought, you know, wow, there's probably a lot that's not being reported. Like what you mentioned, the driving ban just repeated and repeated, even though it's maybe not even really news, because there's protests, but there's not really a legal change. So yeah, no, it was just an interest question.
Yeah. The driving ban, by the way, it wasn't part of the Arab Spring anyway. The driving ban is there for forever in Saudi Arabia. And it's only in Saudi Arabia. It's only one country. It's only, But because there were these uprisings, and you have people or women asking for their rights, etc., then it was a chance for them. And so you have all Saudi women sometimes, videotaping themselves driving and put it on, because many of them, they do drive. I mean, when they go to they travel, etc., they drive.
Yeah.
But it's only in the country, so. Even if you're not Saudi and you're there, you're not right. I don't know why. No, it's just, this is, yeah.
Thank you for that. I think that kind of statistical analysis is very helpful. But you started by saying, emphasizing how important media and news was in affecting social attitudes and social behavior.
Yeah.
And then you went on to demonstrate how there was a shift in the the image of the Arab woman through the catalyst of the various Arab Springs. What evidence have you found, or are there other social science kind of surveys being undertaken on the back of that analysis that might suggest that social attitudes in Germany or in Northern Europe have indeed changed towards the Arab world? Because in my country, it seems to me that the discourse of the Arab woman as victim has only served to intensify a traditional Orientalist approach towards the Arab world, and I don't think that that's been terribly progressive.
Could you, I'm not sure if I got your question. I mean, is it like, are you saying that this is not basically, I mean, related to the Arab Spring, or is it?
No, I'm asking you, you started by saying that the media, that media affect social attitudes and forms of behavior.
Yeah.
I'm asking, as a consequence of the research that you found in the shift in attitudes towards the Arab women, have actual social attitudes and forms of behavior towards the towards Arabs, Muslims, and the Arab world changed?
Yeah.
Because my experience in my country of looking at a very similar a range of responses to women fighting for rights has been precisely to emphasize their victimhood and thereby reinforce an Orientalist view of the Arab world rather than to undermine it.
Yeah.
It's a question.
Yeah. Of course, I mean, this goes, I mean, if you, Edward Said in his book, Orientalism, and he goes through this, you know, and he explains this, and of course, what you're saying is true, the Orientalist view towards the Arabs in general and to women in general, and intensifying their oppression and victimization. It's the stereotype, it has been there for decades. But maybe the shift, I mean, we cannot deny the role of media, even the visual, the visualization, especially like when you open the newspaper or you go to a website, etc., and you see pictures of women fighting, etc., which wasn't there. I mean, this whole thing of Arab Spring, regardless whether women or men, wasn't there for decades, like fighting for their rights, etc. So it's, I agree with you, but also we cannot deny the role of the Arab Spring in that and media in that.
A small question about a detail that is perhaps relevant to this point. I was struck by the occurrences, the frequency of the word of the words in the empowerment semantic field. And you said that these words are more common in the headlines than in the texts. So I ask, first of all, is it true for both subcorpora, so the English language and the German? And this is the first question. And then, do you think that this is an indication that there is a sort of will on behalf of the newsmakers to emphasize this idea of empowerment and to attract the readership, as in the headlines, of course, you have the more emotional and the more attracting part of the communication?
Thank you for your question. There are discrepancies between the German corpus and the English corpus, and in all, let's say, eight themes. And you can see some of those are emphasized in the English corpus more than in the German corpus or the otherwise. And some of the themes are emphasized in both, in the headlines and the articles. Yes, there are. And of course, I didn't go through the details because of the limitation of time, but there are, As for the headlines, I think it's not just the empowerment. I mean, it's other themes. Usually headlines are used to attract attention. And sometimes the headline, you read the headline, and when you read the full article, it doesn't have to do, much with it. I mean, the thing is, like, for example, with Tawakkul Kurman and the Peace Prize, Nobel Peace Prize, this is a big event, like, for an Arab woman to get a Nobel Prize, you know, and, yeah. Like, and at such an early age, etc. So it was emphasized in the headlines, yes. And for sure, yeah, sometimes the headlines is to attract the attention, yes.
One last question.
I have a question that follows up on this last two.
Yeah.
At first, I couldn't understand during your talk why there was a discrepancy between the percentage of men and women that were interviewed. But now I understand that since they're all students of English, there could be also gender dimension in their response, etc. So this leads me to the question about any thoughts about a German specificity, meaning you're facing this challenge of charting discourse information, which is really, really very complex. But I'm wondering, and I really don't know, but I think I understand that the cities that you used are all in Bavaria, first of all, and then I've no idea who's running the government in Bavaria in the local towns.
Yeah.
But since we're talking about results of women who are talking not just about the Arab Spring, but their perspective on Arab women that they see, how much you think that, you know, the political government could have affected, you know, with all sorts of texts, you know, that give visibility, readability of women, you know, the very results that may not appear in the same way in other lands. I really don't know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, discrepancies between men and women, like you said, they are students. I mean, there's usually in languages you have more women than men. And like I said, I mean, this is not really representative, just like a sample. And we are planning maybe to extend that and expand it and include other parts in Germany and maybe other fields. And this is what we're doing in our next project about refugees. So we'll have people from different, from sciences, from, you know, different fields, so that to be more, no, not necessarily in Bavaria. I have it in other, but not, this one was conducted in Bavaria. In Bavaria because it's for logistics, because I know people there, and I mean, they are more my colleagues, and usually this is what we do in, as academics, it depends on what is available. I mean, if you go to somewhere where you don't know anybody, some maybe people will not be, very willing to help. So they're,
As for the tax, I think there are differences, even in Bavaria. It's not just that, like, if you take Der Spiegel and you take Süddeutsche Zeitung and you have Frankfurt and Allgemeine Zeitung, you find the discrepancies. I mean, you cannot just say that these, but for sure, like, Süddeutsche Zeitung, it is Bavarian one, and So even like in Bavaria, you have different political parties, and
okay, so we are a bit behind schedule anyway. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we are ready to start. So a warm welcome to this panel on Wars of Words, Periodical Quarrels, where we have three really fascinating papers, and it's promising to be a very kind of varied and interesting panel, which picks up on a lot of the core esprit themes of transnationalism and comparative study of periodicals across national and linguistic borders and different cultural contexts, also historically. So it would be very interesting to hear your papers. We're going to do the three papers first and then have questions at the end. And first out is David Weitzam from the Universities of Lorraine and Augsburg, where he is a PhD student and working on De Nouveau Mercure Galant and its reception of the Quarrel of Homer under the supervision of Alain Genetois and Rotro von Kulessa. Not sure how I pronounce that, sorry. And this is within the program of Cultures Européennes de la Communication, which is accredited and supported by the Université Franco-Allemande. Okay. Anyway, please, David. And David is talking on the subject, Conflict is Their Business, Periodicals in the Early 18th Century. Thank you very much, David, for such a thorough overview and analysis of that conflict in two very interesting periodicals. Now, the second paper of this panel is by Héloïse Forestier of the University of Ghent. Héloïse is one of the PhD students on the project We Change, which looks at women editors from a wide range of contexts under supervision of Professor Marianne van Remortel. You might have heard about this project before. Héloïse is covering French, English, and Swedish periodicals. And the working title of her PhD project is The Cross-Cultural International Political Influence of Women Editors of English, Swedish, and French Periodicals During the 19th Century. And today, she's going to talk to us on the topic of private and public conflicts through the polemical lens of Jean-Gabriel Pelletier, Madame de Staël, and Jean-Baptiste Bernadotte in the anti-Napoleonic periodical L'Ambigu. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Eloise. That was really fascinating. We've now got our final paper on this panel, and it's by Sara Boetzio, who is, I am struggling, who is currently working on a PhD thesis at University of Warwick. The title of the thesis is provisionally Images of Turn, Death and Rebirth, Italy's Fin de Siècle, Printed Media in Europe. She's previously studied at Pisa, where her MA thesis won a prestigious award, Galilei Carducci Prize. And she's also spent extended research periods at École Normale Supérieure in Paris and Lyon. And she works particularly on cultural milieu in the late 19th and early 20th centuries from a comparative and interdisciplinary perspective, and takes in influences from history, literature, politics, sociology, and psychology. And today her paper is Polemics About the Century's End in three Fin de Siècle periodicals, La Nuova Antologia, La Vita Internazionale, and La Nuova Parola.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah, for all that rich material. Could I please ask the speakers to come to the front and we will take questions together? I can walk around with it. I think that might be easier because I might need it. Okay, thank you. But thank you. So three really excellent case studies where conflict and the mediation of conflict is at the center, and also following, as Eloise, you were saying, a very nice, and sorry, you too, a nice trajectory, kind of chronological trajectory too, and across Europe. So I'd like to open up for questions straight away.
Hello. I have a question for Eloise about Peltier and Madame de Staël. I can see what the attraction was for Peltier to publish Madame de Staël as this big figure, etc. But what was the reverse relation, right? Why did Madame de Staël choose to publish with Peltier, who had a bad reputation, even though he was a good journalist? Could you explain a bit more, please?
Thank you. To start with, apologies because I have not been able to follow the entire panel because one has to make so many choices. I was wondering, this is for Sara Boezio, I was wondering to what extent it wouldn't be useful for you to look at this in a more transnational perspective, because you have these parallel discourses on the birth of the new century, both in France, in the UK, and certainly in the Spanish context. So that's one remark. And I was wondering, you know, when you look at the answers Cervezzato's inquiry, can you trace these writers back to where they belong, to their original context? That's one question. And then I was wondering whether more generally, how do you interpret yourself this new representation of a new century? Are you convinced by it? What are you going to do with this figure?
Thank you.
Thank you. Got time for a couple more questions before lunch?
Well, it's a question for David. Well, actually, it's more a comment than a question. I found very interesting what you say about the fact that really that debate was not a fake one, it was a real debate, but the idea was, the basic idea was to create an audience through this debate, and also I think you said something like spectacularization, which is a very modern idea, and I wonder whether you would like to add something on that topic, because the debate between Madame Dacier, Monsieur de la Motte, really, you know, was sort of an instrument, a tool to reach a wider audience. Thank you. Literature and commerce, yes, which was discussed yesterday as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think I'm going to conclude there and once again thank three really fantastic papers and some very good questions. Thank you all for coming.